right now. Listen up.
3, 2, 1.
It's showtime.
That's great.
This is ridiculous.
99.3 The Truth.
You can't handle the truth. Right now.
Ooh. That's the stupidest thing I ever heard.
Let's do it.
Hit it.
It's time for Max World.
And here we go.
Everybody here. Everybody here. Let's get it started.
Call Matt 244-0077 or text 809-0993.
It's showtime, everybody! Showtime!
Exclusively on 99.3 The Truth.
7 minutes after 4 o'clock on the 30th day of November in the Lord's year 2016. I'm J. Michael McCoy. 31 days in November, right?
30.
So tomorrow's the 1st of December.
1st of December.
25 shopping days till Christmas. It just doesn't seem so. But if you drive by the corner of Hickman and Beaver, you will find that once again for the 20-something year,
yep.
First Church of the Open Bible has their Christmas trees all colored and decorated and lit up, but it's different this year.
Yep. If you turn into 98.5, as you're sitting in the parking lot or go across the street in a parking lot over there, it is syncopated to message and music. It's just really powerful.
So it's a light show.
It is.
And 98.5?
98.5.
It's one of those little transmitters that go like a block and a half.
Yep.
And it's a light show that moves. And so do you kind of like holiday jolly lights? Do you have to go?
No, you're not driving through it, but you can just watch it. And it is really powerful. One of our guys in the church had a real dream for this and works his tail off every year to help us with the lights. But this last couple of years here with this new way of doing the lights is incredible. Plus, we have a new display with a blue Christmas tree as a police memorial. Love for any of our police families to come out and see that and know that we're praying for them and care about them.
Well, that's awesome. And that's Spencer Karoff from the First Church of the Open Bible. And you guys are having a vendor fair this Saturday, 8 to 4. Tell us a little bit about that. And you got a couple openings.
Yeah, it's a holiday vendor fair. We have about 3 to 4 openings for vendors still. 8 to 4 p.m. It's $50 if you're a vendor. Want to set up a booth. We provide the table and the space. And you provide the wares. And then anybody that's looking for a place to do some shopping this Saturday, 8 to 4. Love to have people come in. And we've got all kinds. We've got Pampered Chef's going to be there. We got Essential Oils is going to be there. We've got crafts and displays going to be there. We've got one of our chiropractors in town is going to be there talking about maximized living. And so lots of different options. We've got organic meats being sold this Saturday as well. So we would love to have, but we need about 3 or 4 more vendors. And again, only $50.
Yeah, that's really inexpensive.
Right. And everything is being raised for our kids ministry at First Church. And would love to have some vendors. Our office just closed, so I'm going to give my cell phone over the air. I don't normally do that. But 515-218-0289. 515-218-0289. If you are a vendor out there listening and you would like to set up a booth, please call me yet today and would love to get you set up.
And no competitors.
No competitors.
So you might get a no when you call. Now, if you are a craftsperson and you create crafts yourself, then obviously there's not a competition thing there.
Exactly.
And you'll be able to come out. And it runs from 8 to 4 Saturday afternoon. All right. This is Max World here live on 99.3 The Truth. Glad to have you with us today. Spencer Karoff from First Church of the Open Bible at Beaver and Hickman. Services at 8:30 and 10 o'clock. I'm sorry. I got it. Services at 8:30 and 10:30.
Yes.
Every Sunday morning. What are you preaching on this Sunday?
We're starting our brand new Christmas series. It Happened in a Manger. And so every Sunday.
That's original.
I know.
I mean, wow. But, holy Toledo, what could he be talking about? The separation of goats and sheep.
but it really is phenomenal and incredible when you think about what happened in that manger. And so every week throughout the month of December, we're just going to be in awe again of God coming to earth, taking on the form of a baby of all things, and growing up to be our life leader and forgiver.
You know, I was listening to a preacher the other day, and he made the reference that the day that Christ was born on earth, the battle, the war, the spiritual warfare with the accuser was done. that because Christ came, the war ended.
I wouldn't agree with that. Otherwise, Paul's words in Ephesians 6, which were after Christ had already ascended, make no sense when he said that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. Now, Jesus, we find out in 1 John, did come to destroy the works of the devil, and he started the process of restoration. So you think about someday.
Maybe that's what it is.
Someday there's not going to be sickness. Someday there's not going to be sin. Someday we're going to be not only delivered from the penalty of sin and the power of sin, but the presence of sin. We can't imagine what that's like.
All right. So help me define that a little bit then. So by the birth of Christ on earth that Christmas day, it didn't end the spiritual battles and the spiritual warfare, but it was the beginning of the end.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We're starting to see the restoration of all things, which is what God's whole goal is. Paradise was destroyed in the Garden of Eden. Paradise will be restored someday.
Yeah. Okay, good. All right. All right. We are kind of talking about evangelism and discipleship today. I came in with four different Bible verses. I guess I came in with a couple and Frank added a couple. Basically, the one we were studying this morning in my men's study was Acts 13:51, when Paul and Barnabas were being attacked by a mob instigated by some of the women and city leaders in a community where the Gentiles completely accepted the gospel, but the Jews didn't. And so they ran him out of town on a rail. And at one point or another, Barnabas and Paul shook the dust off their feet in protest. Now, are you comfortable with that word, protest?
It's an interesting word. I've not seen that in I was looking at a couple different translations, and I've not seen that word. So
what word would you use?
Well, again, like the New King James that I have here, they shook the dust off from their feet against them. Okay, so in protest against them, I don't know. And then I had the Holman Christian Standard that said, but they shook the dust off their feet against them. So again, that. I think I don't want to get caught up in just a word. I really do want to get caught up in the symbolism of what they were trying to do.
All right. And so what do you think they were trying to
do? Well, you know, it's interesting, Mac, because when the Jews were in mourning, there are a couple of different things that they would do. They put on sackcloth and ashes, and they would pour dust over their heads. Okay. It was a sign of brokenness, sign of mourning. It's almost as if in the symbolism here that Paul and Barnabas are saying, God opposes the proud. We're shaking the dust off of our feet. We're not even mourning for you right now. God opposes the proud. He gives grace to the humble. It wasn't a total rejection. I think that there were Gentiles, obviously, who were getting saved, so the gospel could still get to these Jews, but it was just a visible symbol. It was like an illustrated sermon that you better understand what you're doing in rejecting this gospel. I think it was a wake-up call.
Frank?
Let me ask this, going back to last hour's conversation, because Bob and I generally, a lot of times, think the same thoughts. When Chris was bringing
Bob,
up...
Bob, do you want to comply with that, or would you like to just say maybe not?
He did say occasionally.
Occasionally, okay.
But we had the same thought here when Chris was talking about the people were getting ready to run him out of town. It's like, well, why stay? But yet, martyrdom is something that we're... potentially is required of Christians. We're told that Christ precisely told us we would be sent out as sheep among wolves, and we would be hated for my name's sake. So were they really to run in that instance, or was this an act of defiance that God's not going to accept this act of defiance that you're rejecting him, and God is telling us to dust our feet, and we're obeying God, what God said. This wasn't them doing it on their own accord, right? Or running for their own lives to preserve their own lives.
Yeah, again, I think it was an illustrated sermon. I think that's the best way to look at it. That through Paul and Barnabas' actions, God was still trying to wake up the Jews. Does that make sense?
Right.
That you're rejecting the gospel. And so it's that serious that I'm going to do an illustrated sermon, if you will, to show you how serious this is.
And Bob's point is Stephen didn't run. He stood there and took a stoning and died in the cause of Christ. So clearly, I think this whole thing, Well, let me ask you this. When it comes to atheists, and you brought up the pearls among swine. Don't cast your pearls among swine. I find a lot of conversations with atheists on Facebook just lead to nowhere because they really don't want the truth. They want to argue. They want to snipe and pick at the truth you're presenting them. At some point, I look at it like dusting my feet. I'm not going to entertain this conversation forever.
Right. I think we have to be extremely cautious. My goal, and when I'm talking about Jesus to people, I'm not even trying to win the argument. I'm trying to win the person.
Right.
And so if somebody only wants to argue, and I can debate with the best of them, and I can have a cantankerous attitude in debate for debate's sake, and I think that's sin. Debate for debate's sake is sin. When you're presenting truth to try and win somebody, that's different. And if somebody honestly is just playing with you, I think you do, quote unquote, shake the dust off your feet and move on.
Well, and that's one of the reasons we like Chris John.
Right.
Because when Chris John comes on, who's the head of the atheists and free thinkers up at Iowa State, and he worked for Hillary Clinton, I mean, just so many things just point in the wrong direction with him. But he's a good guy.
Yeah.
And when he talks to us about where he's coming from, it's never petty. It's never snide. It's a good conversation.
But he once was a believer. And when you talk about restoration, you can't be restored to something you never had, right?
Right.
So a believer can be restored, but a non-believer, it's a different thing, right?
Yeah, well, they actually need to come to salvation.
Right.
All right, let's take a break. We're coming back. Spencer Karoff, First Church of the Open Bible. They've got their big vendor fair this Saturday, 8 to 4. A few booths, spots left. $50. If you want one, let me know here at the station. We'll get you lined up. Live here on The Truth. Yep, that's right. It's The Truth.
Credit cards are like grandkids. They love you, sometimes get out of control, and it's fun to get a new one. Who can stop them from piling on?
Hi, I'm Tom Coates with Consumer Credit of Des Moines. At the end of the day, you can return the grandkids, but you're stuck paying off bad credit card debt. We'll help you put the fun back into using credit cards responsibly. Right, kids?
Yeah!
If you need help getting credit cards off your back, call Consumer Credit of Des Moines.
Hi, my name is David Burrier, your Hope Coach. I host a live weekly talk show called I've Been There every Thursday afternoon at 5:30, right here on webcastonelive.com, and on my weekly radio program Saturday mornings at 10 on Truth Network 99.3 FM. I interview common everyday people who have survived incredible life challenges and who testify to God's faithfulness in the midst of their storms. So join me as we bring a message of hope and encouragement. Everybody needs hope. I know, because I've been there.
Hey, everybody. I brought Northern Lights Pizza. And it's got Graziano sausage.
Rockton Prevention is celebrating 25 years of creating a caring community. We want to say thank you to the tens of thousands of Rock High School mentors that have carried our message of health, love, and encouragement to over 1.5 million children, teachers, and parents. Our mentors teach children methods and skills to prevent bullying and drug use. Thank you to all the school administrators, teachers, and counselors for the opportunity to serve you. Rock on, fair citizens. Rock on. This is Pat McManus for Rock and Prevention, Richard O. Jacobson Foundation, and this station.
From
from the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios, this is Webcast One Live. From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios, this is Webcast One Live.
Have a holly jolly Christmas. It's the best time of the year. I don't know if there'll be snow, but have a cup of cheer.
Come on. 21 minutes have after 4 o'clock. Have a jolly Christmas. Burl Ives.
And when you walk down the street,
no longer with us, but that will be a classic for all time. And next week, my producer, Jebediah, has promised that we're going to have contemporary Christian music that we're going to play for bumpers. So we're going to go back and forth a little bit and going to hear some of my favorites. Have you ever listened to Mercy Me's Red? I think it's called Red Christmas album. It's about 5 or 6, 7 years old.
I know.
Phenomenal.
I know the cover.
Yeah. Phenomenal. Phenomenal.
Do I own that?
They do. They do. Trying to think of the one version that they do that I just love. But anyway, great, great album to buy. Great Christmas presents to give is Christmas CDs. All right, Spencer Karoff from First Church of the Open Bible is here today as we talk about discipleship and evangelism. I want to remind you that First Church of the Open Bible at Beaver and Hickman, who meets at 8:30 and 10:30 every Sunday morning, is having this Saturday, a vendor fair. 35 vendors, no competitors, so 35 different things that you can look at. Great way to you know, do a little Christmas shopping. Starts at 8 a.m. sharp and goes till 4 p.m. in the afternoon. It's only, it's free to get in. And you'll have, I'm assuming you always have refreshments and things.
Absolutely,
like that.
Absolutely, yeah.
Come by.
Yep, come on by. Come on by for lunch.
Yeah.
There you go.
Bring the whole family.
And if you've got, if you'd like to get in on the vendor program, you can. There's a couple spots left. Get a hold of me here at the radio station, or call me on my cell phone, or hit me up on Facebook, or email me. If you go to my website at MacMcKoy.com, my cell phone and everything is public knowledge. So feel free to call, and we'll get you in as long as it's not competitors. We got essential oils.
Essential oils.
We've got Pampered Chef.
Yep. Organic meats. We've got, I haven't mentioned, we have a lady who's a massage therapist coming
nice.
In. She'll, I do a couple of freebies in her chair while you're there. And yes, yeah, so we've got homemade crafts that are well done and jewelry. This is going to be a great time.
All right. And that's Beaver and Hickman right there where they always have the beautiful Christmas tree display. And this year they have a beautiful Christmas tree display, except it all dances to music. And you can listen to that at 98.5 when you drive by. It's one of those transmitters that puts out a signal for about a mile, or I'm sorry, about a block. And it's really incredible to see. Plus, they have a blue tree in honor of the police people this year. You know, one of the things that I've been really pleased with is the number of people who put a blue streak
yes.
on the back of their car. I did something that I thought was kind of unique and very proud of it. Oh, there's that proud word. I wasn't proud. I was humbled. Anyway, I put a blue one across the front of my grill as well as the back.
Oh, neat.
So they could see it coming. Yeah. So, all right. You were talking a little bit about people that you didn't give up on. And I don't care if you use names or not. You don't have to. Bless you. But you've got people in your life that have come to Christ through the Holy Spirit and your constant nagging, I mean evangelizing. And tell us a little bit about some of those.
Yeah. Well,
I don't agree with these Bible verses. I'll just tell you, I don't agree with Jesus on this. I don't.
Well, that's a different story. Again,
I never give up on somebody.
No. So think about it this way, Mac. I think the shaking of the dust is a sermon illustration. So did Jesus use other kinds of sermon illustrations?
Yeah.
Absolutely. So this was a sermon illustration. Let me put it in this vernacular. Maybe this will help you. When we lived in a southern Iowa town, we were working on our basement. We had stuff in our garage. We couldn't park in our garage. Our garage was kind of at an angle.
Mm-hmm.
And so we had to park our vehicle at the bottom of the driveway because we had... an old minivan where if you just open the doors, they would come flying open and we had little kids. And so we had parked down there. Well, there were a couple times that I told my kids to go out the front door and get in the van. And our son was probably 2, maybe 3 and his sister a little older. Well, she knew not to go in the street. She'd been taught that. And Josiah was learning that. But there were a couple times that I'd open the front door, I'd say, go down and get, and I could tell he was running out to the streets. Now, at the top of my lungs, I yelled out, Josiah, stop! Now, did I yell that because I hate my son? Absolutely not.
No.
I yelled that because I love my son.
Okay.
But I yelled it. I believe that the shaking of the dust was a sermon illustration, not because Jesus hated the Jews. He loved the Jews. It was an illustration to say, you are rejecting something so critical. You need to be aware of that. So I think you really probably want to rethink your wording when you say you disagree with Jesus. But really, you need to think about it.
He doesn't listen to this show very often. He just proved it right there.
He's just encouraging you.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. I just want to be an encouragement. but anyway, think of it as a sermon illustration. But I was bringing up at break a couple of people that I know that are actually a brother and sister who the brother lived in the homosexual lifestyle for 21 years. And the sister lived in the lesbian lifestyle for about the same time, about 20 plus years.
Those parents must have really been sad.
The parents were very sad. Yeah. And honestly, the parents were the sweetest people that you would ever want to meet. The mom just passed away here this last year, but just the sweetest, sweetest couple. And they continued to pray, believe God. They continued to love on their kids when their kids would come around. Now, they never compromised what they believed about homosexuality, that it was a sin. They never compromised that. They didn't lower their standards, but they always embraced the kids when the kids were willing to come around. And now, here we are years later, and the brother has given his life to Jesus Christ, lives here in the Des Moines Metro. Some people would know him if I said his name. Sister has come out of the lesbian lifestyle, given her heart to Jesus Christ, because the parents didn't give up. They kept presenting the gospel, and they kept presenting love.
So why didn't they shake the dust off their feet?
Again, I think mom and dad used other kinds of sermon illustrations.
Okay.
I'll never forget when I met the sister. For the very first time, I was pastoring this little church in southern Iowa. Mom and dad were actually members of my church and founders of that church. And the very first time I met, she was so hard and cold and piercing with her eyes.
Oh, yeah.
And I found out later, and I didn't know this, but she told me later after she came to faith in Jesus Christ, she said, I hated you.
Yeah.
When you were preaching, and I wasn't even preaching on homosexuality that day. It had nothing to do, but I was just preaching the word. And she said, I hated every minute of it. I hated you. She was piercing her eyes at me. And about probably 3 months after that situation, she had given her heart to Jesus Christ. And the next time I saw her, I'm like, she looks.
Yeah.
And I mean, you could just sense the aura around her. That's a wrong word to say, but just she was a completely transformed person. That's a miracle. That's a complete miracle. But I would say her parents probably used different sermon illustrations, if you will, that she would have understood, that he would have understood, and to try and wake their kids up.
That's awesome. Spencer Karoff is here. He's a pastor of the First Church of the Open Bible. At the corner of Hickman and Beaver. Of course, they've got their Christmas tree, a light-up Christmas tree display out now. And you can also check out one of their services, 8:30 and 10:30 on Sunday morning.
Now, the parents of these two kids that strayed, they were Christian parents, correct?
Yes. Oh, absolutely.
Well, obviously, in the Bible, it talks about training a child the way they shall go and they won't depart. Now, it doesn't say deviate at some point. We're all going to deviate away from truth at some point. So it goes back to what I was saying. The restoration is the process of bringing somebody back to something that was already instilled in them. You can't restore somebody to something that never had it to start with. So clearly the parents were following, you know, the truth of God to continue to pray and love your children, trusting him that Christ would bring them back. What do you do about the parent that trained their child the opposite way? It kind of goes the same way. You train a child the way they shall go that's wrong. They're not going to depart from that either, would you say?
No, I disagree, because I think that's the power of salvation. I grew up in a religious home, but I didn't grow up in a home that heard the gospel. And it was because my brother accepted Christ at Mankato State University, going to school there. The Navigators started sharing Jesus with my brother, and he came home and announced to the family he was a born-again Christian. I had no idea what that was. I thought he was going to shave his head and sell flowers at the airport. I was 13 years old, but out of that situation, it wasn't because of how our parents were. I was raised in religion. That my mentality was, hey, I've never done any of the big sins.
Right.
I've never raped anybody, never murdered anybody, never robbed a bank. My good will outweigh my bad. That's religion. That's the essence of religion. How much I've done for God rather than, you know, how much I've sinned. And I, you know, yeah, I'd sinned, but I hadn't done the big stuff, you know, or at least in my mind, the big stuff. And so, I would disagree with that, Frank. I think that God can intervene at any time he wants to bring the gospel.
Sure.
You know, something else that struck me a little bit that's interesting about the shaking your dust off the feet as a symbol. I think Pastor Spencer, you and Pastor Michael Damascus in the first hour talked about that, how that would have been a symbol that the Jewish folks at the time would have understood. It would have been a symbol that they would have been able to relate to, that when they saw that occur, it would have meant something to them that would have given them pause. It would have shocked them. It would have sent a message to them saying, we're leaving you. We are not going to take you with us. We are taking the peace that we have. We're not leaving it here. We're taking the peace and we're leaving. That's different, I think, than sharing the gospel or not sharing the gospel. And again, that kind of goes back to the confusion that I think we often get in these conversations. Paul and Barnabas never stopped sharing the gospel. They didn't quit. And they didn't give up, nor did God give up on the Jews, nor did God give up on the people of this community in which we're talking about, where Paul and Barnabas shook the dust from their feet. But the symbol was one to, as you pointed out, Pastor Spencer, to wake them up. And sometimes we need that. Sometimes that's just the law. In a sense, to the Jewish people, this may have been like walking someone through the Ten Commandments. Maybe they just needed to be woken up to the severity of their crime. They had committed a crime against God. God had come to the world, demonstrated his love for us, taking the full punishment for our sin. This gospel message came to the Gentiles in this town, and the religious leaders of the day hated God's love towards the Gentiles. That was a crime against God. That was a crime in God's eyes. And so they were given this symbol to recognize, you have violated the law of God. And so maybe a different way of thinking about it, Mac, is not so much whether or not we are sharing the gospel or not sharing the gospel with someone, but how are we sharing it with the person we're sharing it with? As Pastor Spencer pointed out, the Bible says that we give God, what is it? God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. You're a prideful, arrogant son of a gun. God didn't resist you. He ran to you, and you are a son of God now. You've been changed, but you're a prideful, arrogant person. So what does it mean that he resisted the proud? What does that mean?
Are you asking?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know, because I don't think he does resist the proud.
Well, he says he does. So he has to do it, and he does it in a way that's different. He treats the proud in a way that's different than he treats the humble.
Could it be also that Christ was just asking them to plant seed and merely move on? Because you can't potentially reach everybody. Somebody else may come along and pick up where Paul or Barnabas left off and add something to it, and then the seed may germinate.
Absolutely. And Mac, let me ask you this question. Was the shaking of the dust off of their feet still a symbol in preaching the gospel?
Yes.
Exactly. It was a picture. It was still a picture. It was a picture to still reach them. That's the point.
Spencer Karoff, First Church of the Open Bible, is with us today. Services 8:30 and 10:30 this Sunday. You might want to join him. Tell him you heard it here, live on The Truth.
Northern Lights Pizza's amazing garlic butter makes amazing breadsticks. Now available in 12-ounce bottles at Northern Lights, Hy-Vee, and Graziano's. Northern Lights Pizza.
I'm Brian Leach, owner of Service Legends, and my position is Chief Talent Officer.
I'm Nicholas Wonderscheid.
I am Bernie Hobbs.
And I'm the Service Manager.
Marketing Director and Client Relations Manager.
Everything that we do is about ensuring that we exceed your expectations.
Our clients are important to us. 100% satisfaction.
We're not just focused on heating and cooling. That's the easiest part of our job, actually, is fixing furnaces and air conditioners.
Everyone that we come in touch with, we want to improve lives.
Bottom line is, we've got our installation guarantees, 25% energy savings guarantee, comfort guarantee, temperature selection guarantee, property protection guarantee.
100% satisfaction guaranteed. Fixed rate or it's free.
All of those guarantees are backed up with a 100% money-back guarantee to hold ourselves accountable to making sure that you get what you're after.
Just fixing the problem today, if they have another problem 5 days down the road, it's still fixed rate or it's free.
We use what's called straightforward pricing. Our technicians are going to give you an exact to-the-penny price on what it's going to take before they move forward with any repair. That way you know what to expect.
It's the same price every day.
No surprises.
If you get off work at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, you come home, you realize that, oh, my furnace is broken. Now you need to call somebody out that night. You shouldn't have to pay more for that.
We're guaranteeing service 24/7.
We run afternoons, evenings, nights, weekends. We're staffed to work that.
Phone rings at 3 in the morning. You'll get one of our representatives answering the phone every time.
We're not sending you out to Timbuktu in some call center. It's our Service Legend team members, our mission control team.
I'll take a call anytime.
And then they answer the phones the same way during the day as they do at night.
It's a great day at your service company. How can we make you smile?
That's the only way to provide true 24-hour service.
When you're able to let somebody actually live in their home safely when they weren't able to do that before, where they don't have to stay up at night and worry about, is the heat going to come back on? Are we going to freeze the pipes? Is the baby in the room next door going to be sick because they got too cold? When you're able to help somebody overcome challenges like that, that's impacting a life. That makes a difference. I get goosebumps thinking about it.
I love the team. I love the people that I work with.
We have fun, but we work hard.
I call them my ambassadors of legendary service. If you could just envision what that is, that's who we're sending to your home.
They literally will call in, pick up the phone and call and say, hey, I want to talk to your manager. And I get on the phone, they're like, that technician that was at my house was the greatest technician ever. That's cool to me.
We want to brighten people's days.
Every person that we have going into the house has gone through an extensive background check.
Drug testing. We have a very thorough interview process that 1 out of 140 people make it through.
We promise you something, that's what you're going to get, no matter what.
We're here when you need us to protect the safety and comfort of your family.
If you're not happy, we're going to make it right.
If we're willing to put 100% money back guarantee on what we do, what type of work do you think we do?
Give us a call. We're there for you 24/7, 365 days a year.
Enough said.
From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios, this is Webcast One Live.
Oh, come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye, oh, come.
Top of the hour, top of the hour, Salem Radio Network News, and then Hank, the Bible Answer Man at 1-888-ASK-HANK. And you can call in today and ask any question that you'd like. Maybe you want to ask him about Jesus's demand or suggestion or whatever you want to call it. It's in three of the four Gospels and in Acts where he instructs people that if your evangelism... if the gospel is falling on deaf ears, that you can shake the dust off your feet and move on. One interpretation, translation says that you should do it in protest. And I know what it says, and I made the joke earlier that I disagree with Jesus, which is okay. I think it's okay to disagree with Jesus. In fact, I had a preacher once tell me that the best conversations you'll ever have with Jesus is when you disagree, and that he loves that. He loves that engagement of that passion at that level, which is certainly the Jesus that I've gotten to know the last 6 years. You know, I don't buy this peace loving, peace sign, white robe, I love everybody kind of Jesus. Jesus called some of the Jews brood of vipers. And I can't say on a commercial radio station what that translation would be in 2016. But you'd have your mouth washed out with soap by your grandma. Jesus was a rebel. He was James Dean with a cross. Jesus was not this passive, grace-filled individual that so many times we want to paint him into that corner. Oh, yes, he had grace. Yes, he was a forgiving man. I wish we could all learn the level of forgiveness that Jesus knows. But it wasn't the guy on the road. It wasn't the guy in the temple. It wasn't the guy at the well. It was you. The amount of grace that Jesus gives you is what ought to put you in shock and awe. Because you and I were wretched. And we can't help it, by the way. If you're offended by the fact I just called you wretched, that makes you very, very proud. The Bible says we are wretched. We are wretched souls. We are born to burn everything good and to despise everything Jesus said and to mock and to laugh at those who sit in the pews with their arms in the air, praising Jesus, worshiping Jesus, not just on a Sunday, but every day, driving down the road with the radio on and a song comes on. And you begin to feel your eyes well up with tears because the words speak truth into your heart of what he's done for you. And it's grace. It's the thief on the cross. There was no time for baptism. There was no time for water baptism. There was no time for evangelism. Jesus welcomed him that moment. What could be more grace than that? And yet there are people every day who take the words in the Bible from all four corners and make people feel horrible, horrible about the life that they're living. Now, I know you're going to disagree. Some of you are going to disagree with the next thing I'm about to say, but I believe this to be truth in my heart. We didn't choose a wretched life. It was handed to us. All the way back from our ancestors, Adam and Eve, we were handed a wretched life. We were handed a life in which we could no longer be the person, the mother, the father, the husband, the wife, the grandparent, the pastor, the sister, the brother. We can't be the way we were created to be. We were not created to be wretched. We were created to glorify him and worship him. And live with a peace and a joy and a makarios in our heart that no one ever doubted would come from the one who created us to be so. But sin fell from the accuser, and we're born wretched. We're born broken people. You say, well, babies don't sin. They're wretched people. You don't just all of a sudden turn three and get wretched. You stop pooping in your diapers and now you're wretched. We have to be willing to humble ourselves before Jesus and ask for forgiveness. And even if you want to measure it, I don't know. I don't know if grace is bigger than forgiveness. But I think grace is what we get when we're forgiven by him. You know, I've heard people say before, well, I can't forgive myself. Who do you think you are, God? God's already forgiven you. You didn't even have to ask. Oh, I know about repentance. I get it. You don't think God doesn't grant you grace and forgiveness before you ever utter the words? That's what grace from God is. You don't have to ask. Your heart wants to. Your heart longs to surrender to him and say, what a wretched soul I am. God, forgive me. And grant me the grace that only Jesus could produce with the blood on the cross. And as I end every prayer with my arms around your ankle, Christ, with my arms around your ankles at the foot of the cross, I love you, Jesus. I love you and thank you for that unbelievable gift that cannot get wrapped up and put under the tree. You can't buy it on an Amazon gift card. You can't even make it. Only he can grant you that grace, which is the greatest gift of all. 15 minutes before the top of the hour, we've been talking a little bit about evangelizing and discipleship. You know, we talked a little bit about it, and I know, Chris, you mentioned this earlier, about how there are people that we can't seem to give up on when it comes time to preach in the gospel. But what I'm hearing for one of the first times in my life today is it's actually instructed by Jesus sometimes to shake the dust off our sandals and walk away.
Well, I think that...
You disagree with that?
Well, I would... here's a controversial statement. I agree with you in disagreeing with Jesus, because that's not what Jesus was saying.
Hold on. You disagree with me.
No, I agree with you in your disagreement with Jesus, because you're disagreeing with something Jesus wasn't saying. So that's what I'm saying. That is confusing, right?
Wow, I'm confused.
Good. So... and we were trying to make this point, I think, earlier. There's a distinction between shaking the dust. There is a symbol here that we're missing, because we're Gentiles, right? We're Gentiles that live in the 21st century in Iowa. And the symbol of shaking dust off of shoes means nothing to me. If Mac... you took your shoe off and shook it and walked out, I would think you're just crazy. You're just a loony. That symbol doesn't mean anything. So that symbol isn't a tool to communicate with me. You can't use that tool to communicate with me. So the symbol of shaking a shoe and knocking the dust off of it was a symbol that would have made sense to a particular people group.
The Jewish people, right? Wouldn't have made sense to the Gentiles.
Right. Wouldn't have made sense to them. Wouldn't even have been something that they would have done. That's not a symbol for them. So we have to recognize that symbol was done for a particular people group to communicate a certain something to them. And what was that certain something? Well, I'm not a great scholar. I'm not Jewish. I don't know what that symbol fully means, and it would take a lot of investigation. But we become an error. We create an error when we take one thing, which is a symbol to mean something, and we make it to mean something that it doesn't. The Bible is crystal clear that we should never stop preaching the gospel, that we should always, in season and out of season, preach the gospel, that we should be faithful to love all of those who God has instructed us to love without stopping.
We're coming back. No, we're not going to stop. Live here on The Truth.
From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios, this is Webcast One Live.
Credit cards are like grandkids. They love you, sometimes get out of control, and it's fun to get a new one. Who can stop them from piling on?
Hi, I'm Tom Coates with Consumer Credit of Des Moines. At the end of the day, you can return the grandkids, but you're stuck paying off bad credit card debt. We'll help you put the fun back into using credit cards responsibly. Right, kids?
Yeah!
If you need help getting credit cards off your back, call Consumer Credit of Des Moines.
Rockton Prevention is celebrating 25 years of creating a caring community. We want to say thank you to the tens of thousands of Rock High School mentors that have carried our message of health, love, and encouragement to over 1.5 million children, teachers, and parents. Our mentors teach children methods and skills to prevent bullying and drug use. Thank you to all the school administrators, teachers, and counselors for the opportunity to serve you. Rock on, fair citizens. Rock on. This is Pat McManus for Rockton Prevention, the Richard O. Jacobson Foundation, and this station.
Northern Lights Pizza, your home of the tasty crust. Our garlic butter sauce now available in 12-ounce bottles at Northern Lights, Hy-Vee, and Graziano's.
Northern Lights Pizza.
Hi, my name is David Burrier, your Hope Coach. I host a live weekly talk show called I've Been There every Thursday afternoon at 5:30, right here on WebcastOneLive.com. And on my weekly radio program Saturday mornings at 10 on Truth Network 99.3 FM. I interview common everyday people who have survived incredible life challenges and who testify to God's faithfulness in the midst of their storms. So join me as we bring a message of hope and encouragement. Everybody needs hope. I know, because I've been there.
From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios, this is Webcast One Live. From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios, this is Webcast One Live.
Silent night, holy night.
the top of the hour, as the clock is about a little over seven hours away from taking us to December of 2016. It's hard to believe. It's hard to believe that you and I can waste as much time as we waste. Time goes on. The hands just keep turning. And yet here we are at the end of 17, or at the end of 16. 25 days till Christmas. 31 days till 2017. 2017. Now, I'm 57 years old, and I don't know if that's old or young. Okay, I don't know if I feel any differently than I did when I was 17 years old. But I do know there's been a lot of ticks on the clock. There's been a lot of hands go round. And there's been a lot of time wasted by Mac. Maybe that should be our resolution this year as we enter this holiday season. That we're going to stop wasting God's time. It's not my time to waste. It's not your time to waste. It's His time. It's His plan. You're His creation. How much have you procrastinated against His will this year? How many times has He made it clear to you what He wanted you to do? Good Lord, how many times do we drop to our knees and ask Him, God, what is your will? Your will be done. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. But yet we take our will back. We can walk out of church feeling filled with worship and glory. And the first stop sign comes and somebody doesn't do what you want them to do and it's gone. It's gone. The grace is gone. The forgiveness is gone. The glory is gone. And His will is not being fulfilled. Maybe 2017, as we approach the last 12th of this year, maybe 2017 will be the year where you surrender those things that you keep taking back. And I'm not talking about bad habits or alcoholism or pornography or all those big things that we all struggle with. I'm talking about the little things called wasting His time. It's not your time, just like it's not your money. It's His money. He gifted it to you. He stewarded it to you. Are you doing with it what you're supposed to do? Or do you think it's yours? I'm going to tell you something you don't want to hear. If you think time is yours, you think money is yours, you better examine that thing you call a relationship with Jesus. Oh, I know. I'm no one to talk. I'm as guilty and hypocritical as sin. But there's a light that's come into my life that's begun to make me realize it's not mine. It's not my talent. It's not my skill. It's not my house. It's not my dog. It's not my car. It's not my money. It's not my friends. They're His, and He gifted them to us. And are we good stewards of those gifts? Or do we balk and laugh in His face because we think they're ours? 5 minutes before the top of the hour, of course, Hank the Bible Answer Man coming up. 1-888-ASK-HANK. Frank?
Well, as I was listening to you talk last segment, at the end of the segment, and you were talking about the brood of vipers and et cetera, Christ generally met the unsaved in love. He never disrespected any person that was unsaved. The people that He was smacking around was His kids.
You and I.
Yeah, the believers, the kids who were... Who were His chosen kids is who the message was directed at and who He was calling vipers, a brood of vipers, hypocrites, et cetera, et cetera. But Christ, the commission to the disciples was to heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. They were to preach to the poor, heal the brokenhearted,
give
deliverance
free
to the captives, sight to the blind, and liberty to the bruised. So, you know, this message clearly had to be directed at somebody who had been given a number of privileges that Christ was just about ready to be done with, but He was still reaching out that olive branch and saying, come to Me, ye who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest.
Yeah. Matthew, what are you wasting time on? I'm going to challenge you. We're in a closed studio here, and we can't see outside because of our television technology, but I guess it's snowing.
Flurries, yeah. I think that's what they're telling us.
So, officially, the holidays have begun.
Yeah.
In Iowa, it really doesn't feel like Christmas. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas everywhere you go. A tree in the Grand Hotel, one in the park as well. And then we get to snow. I want to challenge you this holiday season not to buy the best presents for your grandkids or your kids or your wife or your brother or your sister or your mother or your father or whoever. Not to pick that purse, that perfect bottle of wine for your best friend who drinks wine. Or that CD that has all the Christmas music on it. I want to challenge you to give time. You know, almost a year ago, I was diagnosed with a heart problem. And it has caused me to change a lot of things in my life, including getting rid of some dead weight. And that dead weight are people. Because I don't have time anymore. A buddy of mine, J.D. Hatfield, the original Hatfield of Hatfield and McCoy, used to tell me, you have all the time there is. Ain't that the truth? The thing that we don't understand is it's not our time. It's his time. He's granted that time to us. Not for our own joy and selfishness. For his plan and his will. So as you hit Jordan Creek or Valley West or Merle Hay or wherever you go shopping for Christmas this year, I want you to think about giving someone that you love the gift of time. When I had my heart situation, I asked a few of my best friends, if I don't have long on this earth left, what is it that I can give to you? And over and over and over, they said, time. I want you to think about wrapping up time with a bow and a card that says to my favorite grandson, to my favorite granddaughter, to my neighbor, to my choir member, to my pastor. In 2017, I'm going to give you my time because God has given it to me to share with you. I also want to remind you to forgive that gift of grace that came at the foot of that cross with all that blood. He gave all he had. So this year, take that person that you can't forgive and forgive them. Because remember, God is watching. It's not just Santa. God is watching. And as you forgive, that's how you'll be forgiven. I'll see you at church.